I'm standing in the Etches collection in Kimmeridge in Dorset, the new home to the skull of a giant sea monster. Not a dinosaur, but a marine reptile that scientists are agreeing could have beaten T-Rex in a fight. The giant sea monster in question is a Pliosaur, an enormous marine predator that used its intimidating size, strength, and teeth to snatch ichthyosaurs in the ocean around 150 million years ago. This new specimen, believed to have been around 12 meters in length in total, is thought to be a new species, marking a discovery of huge academic potential that all began with the discovery of a fossil snout on a beach in Dorset. Now it's found a new home at the Etches collection. I'm here to speak to Steve Etches and Chris Moore, arguably the stars of a new series from David Attenborough and the BBC, about the discovery of a giant pliosaur skull halfway up a cliff. It wasn't easy getting it out, and we want to hear how it went. Chris and Steve, thank you for letting me into your workshop. Could you just introduce what it is you have to do with this magnificent fossil?
Well, I'm Steve Etches, collector, preparator and general dog's body of the Etches collection here at the museum.
My name's Christopher Moore, and I work with my son Alexander Moore, Alex Moore, and we're in West Dorset in Charmouth next to Wine Regis.
So the Jurassic Coast is extremely famous in the UK for its fossils. Could you just tell some of our overseas viewers why that is?
Fossils along this coast have been collected for hundreds of years now. And it was a shallow, marine, warm sea, very rich in life. And it's constantly eroded by the English Channel. You know, it's in the southwest of the UK. We get big storms that wash away the soft clay and continually reveal new fossils.
The other thing is, from West Dorset to East Dorset, you're walking through the whole suite of Jurassic rocks. So you're going through time. So all the rocks are dipping this way, and they're cut off, and you can see every Jurassic suite sequence of rocks.
You guys had the intimidating task of getting this thing out of the cliff face. When you first saw the snout segment, the video was sent to you, what did you think?
Well, the rest of it's somewhere up in the cliff, and that's what we had to find next. So we put a drone up and scanned all the way along the cliff and then found what looked to be the rest of it stuck out. But again, we need to confirm that. So that meant a trip down the cliff on ropes to actually go down and see. And when it was found, because Philip Jacobs found the thing, when we got it back, realised, well, we went back there to see, well, where's it come out? So we visually looked and thought, there was some talk about could it have gone east? Sometimes you get what we call longshore drift. And I thought, no, it didn't. So we looked up at the cliff and got this drone going, and through that, and some stills we took of lightly looking bits, come to the conclusion, we think we found it.
The whole head had turned upside down, so it had been buried with its lower jaws upwards.
When you find a fossil in a ledge or whatever, we always turn them upside down, because when it dies, the bit that goes down in the mud is undisturbed. It's always the top side that starts to degrade more rapidly. The whole cliff is composed of what we call mudstones. And mudstones is really a very compressed lithified clay. It's really hard for us to excavate into that. But leave it a couple of months and you get wet dry effect and it starts to revert back to clay, that slimy, sticky clay. So it erodes away very, very quickly. You look on these programs and they quarry, it's dead easy, and they have their cups of tea and they brush away. This was nothing like that, I can tell you.
Do you think you could estimate, ignoring sort of the breaks you had to take for sleep and weather, how long the project took once you found it to finally getting it out?
The actual digging, I think, probably took 2 weeks. 2 weeks of continual, like, chiselling to reveal and get to the back of the skull and then to plaster it to keep it safe so we could, you know, actually drag it out. Mm. Initially, we did have that idea of bringing a landing craft in, trying to get it out and then lowering it to the beach. But then the cost and the sheer logistics of doing that became prohibitive. And then it was like, Okay, what else do you do? You know, you create a box, and then with a big digger, a big Hi-Mac, you actually pull it back up the cliff face and take it away from the farmer's field on the top.
And we didn't think about the weight of this thing. It was pretty much of a sort of ton. So the thing then was, it's got to go up the cliff. And a guy who's a farmer, an engineer, really developed this, made this cage and this thing to actually take it up the cliff.
And so then you get back to your workshop, and what are you faced with dealing with at that point?
It was 2 months of lying there, slowly, the mudstone drying and cracking and everything else, and it was, oh. And the BBC, when we took the top of this, what do you think? And I was going, oh my God, how am I going to do this?
What are the biggest signs to your eye that this is a new species we're looking at?
One of the most convincing things for me is this crest. Every other Pliosaur skull we've ever seen has not got that. So that's one really, really unique feature to this. But you see the jawline, which normally ends by the front of the eye. This ends at the back of the eye. So that's something really different.
And I mean, that brings us to the teeth. It's pretty hard to ignore them. Can you talk a little bit about how we've gone from the sort of slightly worn down model and how we end up here?
Steve was on one side of the skull and I was on the other. And on the side I was on, there was a round piece showing. I thought, it's very strange, separate from the skull. I started to dig it out and it was a complete tooth that had fallen out and was just literally in the shale at the side of the skull. So we excavated that and Alex, my son, put it back. It took 14 hours to put glue in the pieces back. And then that gave us a model for what the teeth look like. So we had it scanned to make the sizes for the roots. And then you could scale the complete tooth to make all the various ones.
Often pliosaurs are portrayed with just the crown stuck out of the jaw. These are extended. Well, we know full well now from this specimen that their roots stuck out way beyond the jawline.
What do pliosaurs have that they would have used in life, specialised for their lifestyle, feeding, things like that?
Killing. Very big teeth.
Killing.
For going.
And the thing is, in the collection here, we got lots and lots of bones with huge red triangular bite marks in from these. There's no other reptile that's got these triangular teeth. When these things go to poo, it's rather like a chicken. They don't wee and poo, they do it together, and it's just like a liquid shoots out because everything's digested. So we don't get coprolites or fossil feces with bones in from these animals. It just describes the largest carnivorous reptiles that ever lived.
Is there anything comparable living today?
There's nothing like pliosaurs or the plesiosaurs that exist today. They disappeared at the same time as the dinosaurs did, you know, in that great mass extinction. They think that they swam in a very similar manner to turtles, with the paddles, with the flippers, so their locomotion was like that, and they could turn rapidly.
The only thing that come through, that extinction event that we can relate to now, crocodiles.
Do we think there's anything left to find in the cliff?
There certainly is. The rest of the body's there, I'm sure. It's slightly disarticulated, so it's come apart, but it's all there. We took out part of the shoulder blade, some paddle digits and some of the vertebrae that were at the side of the head, and you could see there was more bones
going
in.
Yeah.
So I'm sure the whole animal's there.
What are the other things that have been uncovered on this stretch of the Jurassic Coast?
Well, world's first ammonite eggs. Everyone knows what an ammonite is, a squid in a shell. We found the world's first ammonite eggs. Flying reptile remains, lots and lots of that. Ichthyosaurs, plesiosaurs, pliosaurs, fish. I mean, fish, we've got a vast range of fish. Invertebrates are interesting as well. So my prime aim is to collect the whole diverse assemblage of what was living at that time from the Kimberley.
But if people want to visit this part of the world, what advice would you give to sort of amateurs that want to get a little taste of what it's like to walk around here?
Well, come to this centre first, for a start. You'll then see the range of material. You've got also West Dorset, you've got the Philpott Museum there, they've got a range of material there.
I mean, basically, people can come all the way along the Jurassic Coast and pick up a fossil, pretty much anywhere along the length of it. You know, whether it's a crushed ammonite, a piece of a fossil squid,
oyster,
there's fossils all the way along it.
And thank you so much for taking the time to take us through it today. It's been incredible to see, and I'm sure people can't wait to come and visit it.
Well done.
Well worth a look, isn't it?
It is. So, getting the skull of a giant sea monster out of a cliff face, not a very easy task, but it does make for great TV, and you can catch the full story on the BBC in Attenborough and the giant sea monster.